This is the continuation of a message of falling away from grace. But this is not about the sin of the church. This is about empowering the church. So we're just going to title it, Receive the Grace of God. And let us repeat just a couple of sentences from where we left off, and we can then go from there and develop this talk. Quote,
we live in an illusion. We live in a deception. Reality is nothing like what we thought. We have to totally switch, shift, paradigm shift, total turnaround, church. God is doing it. He's pouring out His Spirit. He is doing the empowering. But individually we have to receive. And of course it's going to get easier and easier and easier because of the example of
the multitude of ours as we grow in numbers to do the right thing. End quote. So what is the right thing to do? To develop a new system to establish the kingdom of God so that we would have a support system to help those homeless. And of course, God's Spirit then can take dominion and flow because He is willing to do that today. He is willing to pour out the grace upon grace, and He is doing it already. All we need to do is receive it, because even individually, when the Lord says do something and we are not willing to do it, then He has nothing to bless so that His grace cannot manifest. Grace is here. The Scripture is now really alive, that not by might and not by power, but by the Spirit of the Lord. Grace upon grace upon grace upon grace. But until people are sitting in the pews, grace is not coming to them. So let them empower, let's just empower them and send them out. Let's just be every day a little bit of more opportunity to let grace come amongst us. Let's just be that we train our disciples that if they just talk to one person today, if they just be kind and loving to one person today, and if they just would envision that that's our state of being, as opposed to putting up a face when we go out to evangelize. Everybody see that two-facedness. Everybody see the insincerity in that. Everybody see that you are in fear of them. Who will receive that today? I mean, who would want to receive a person coming with their own program? I see Jehovah Witnesses sitting on the corner and putting out their watchtower and putting out their magazines they have, and they have this false humility all around them. They are humble, they are kind, and I know that they mean it, they mean it, they mean it. And they even leave it amongst themselves, but somehow it's just not adding up because there is no living water coming out of that congregation. They just really like legalistic. So actually they will be the one of the leading force of this movement, of the kingdom movement, because they have the discipline, because they have the heart, they have the sacrifice, they made the sacrifice. It's just that they are thinking that they are higher, they are better, they are separated out of the body. But see, that's not what God's body is all about. There is no one part in the body of Christ that is have to be set aside because now they have the truth. I tell you what, I have a kidney and my kidney has the truth of how to work the kidney. And I have the heart and my heart has the truth of how to be a heart. And I have my hand and the hand knows how to be a hand. And God, thank you, Jesus, that they don't have to mix and mingle and they don't have to do each other's work. That doesn't mean they don't love one another. That doesn't mean they are not one body and not working together, flowing together. But it means that they cannot do each other's work. So I can do this and you can do that, and let's support one another. Let's just deliver that nutrition to every part of the body. Let's not withhold from one another. Let's not put up walls for one another. I mean, the separation is naturally taking place. There are just certain, one congregation is doing missions, the other is doing homeless ministry. Of course, they have a different territory. That doesn't mean that they are not equally blessed and not that they are not shouldn't be sharing, and they look at each other, that what's wrong with you, that look down on one another and evangelizing one another. That's what's going on in the churches. We go and say, come and oh, come to my church. My pastor is so anointed. Please, please get real. Please get real with this church worship and this pastor worship and stop it. Stop it. That's an abomination to the Lord. I'm sorry, but I see it everywhere. I mean, those people are in such a high regard that they would be sitting right next to Jesus. I am sorry if they are the servant of all, they are sitting right next to Jesus. That's what He is doing. He's serving us. He's still coming to us for 2,000 years. taking care of all our needs, mending our hearts, repairing our lives. That's all they are doing. He's caring for every single one of us. Now, of course, we cannot care for every one of us of the body, but can we care for those who are around us? Can we care for those who are around us and not just overlook them and say, well, you know, they are really in a bad shape? And again, there is no greater self-deception that you think that you are better than someone else, or your congregation is better, or your denomination is better, or your works are better, or your whatever is better. Shame on you. I'm sorry, I love you. I love you, but now get real with God. Get real with God. Get that mirror of repentance. Look into it. Look into it and see how it affects Jesus Christ. What is he saying about it? How he feels about it? What would he do? That's also is not his thing, that what would Jesus do? Because it's wonderful to really meditate over that, what would Jesus do? But what if we become one and don't have to think about it, just flow in the Holy Spirit because we are so anointed that we are one with Christ and we don't have to think what would Jesus do because it comes naturally. And that's when we are willing to shake those other spirits into the fire and recognize them for what they are. Recognize them that they are not serving us. I was in a congregation one time and I wrote a letter to my pastors because I saw the spirits in operation in that church. There were many. And you know what the result was? They did not say thank you. They wanted to put me out of the church and they asked, are you going to stay with us? Are you going to line up? Line up with what? Line up with Satan? But they haven't received it. Now, so we have a lot to receive. We have a lot to receive and we have a lot to really finally understand that this is not how God designed it to be, and that each and every one of us has to add to this. Each and every one of us have to come to repentance, including me, because none of us is perfect, and it has to be a continuous press in order for us to finally align, finally become one, finally become love. L-O-V-E. Divine love, unconditional love. And then we are the body of Christ. Not before. Until that, we are just little parts scattered around. And you know, Satan is like we know that he's going out and looking for the ones who he can devour, who he will devour. The ones who are on the periphery, who are just scattered around. Easy catch. Everybody is in a pit. I mean, I know so many Christians in my personal life, and I just see them living a lesser life than what God has for us. And it's just time for a change. If we come to the understanding and the realization that what I'm saying is true, then we are willing to receive correction. Now, I know that many will persecute me. The Lord already asked me if that's what I want, because he showed me that I'm going to be persecuted as he was persecuted, of course. Because those who don't want to come off of the high chair, they will persecute me, just like did the Pharisees. Well, you know, welcome to the show. Whatever, God's kingdom is coming, the kingdom is coming, and everyone else will be teared down. And I might be persecuted for a season, but on the end, God will prevail. I love you all. If you don't see that I love you all, then you are, oh gosh, then you really are operating in another spirit. So I love you. God bless you. That's the truth. I stop here. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Okay, I am now going to give a bonus because this is so important and you'll be so blessed by it. I'm going to read from Rick Joyner, Final Quest. That is a priceless publication. It doesn't matter when it was published, at least 20 years ago, but it's for today and you will see it. So please listen to this and you can buy the book anywhere if you wish. Glory to God. The hordes of hell are marching. This is taken from the Morningstar, Volume 5, NOS 2-4, by Rick Joyner. The evil army. I saw a demonic army so large that it stretched as far as I could see. It was separated into divisions, each carrying a different banner. The foremost and most powerful division were pride, self-righteousness, respectability, selfish ambition, and unrighteous judgment. But the largest of all was jealousy. The leader of this vast army was the accuser of the brethren himself. I knew that there were many more evil divisions behind my scope of vision but these were the vanguard of this terrible horde from hell that was now being released against the church. The weapons carried by this horde had names on them. The swords were named Intimidation, the spears were named Treachery, and their arrows were named Accusations, Gossip, Slander, and Fault-Finding. Scouts and smaller companies of demons with such names as Rejection, Bitterness, Impatience, Unforgiveness, and Lust were sent in advance of this army to prepare for the main attack. I knew in my heart that the church had never faced anything like this before. The main assignment of this army was to cause division. It was sent to attack every level of relationship, churches with each other, congregations with their pastors, husbands and wives, children and parents, and even children with each other. The scouts were sent to locate the opening in churches, families, or individuals that rejection, bitterness, lust, and so on could exploit and make a larger breach for the divisions that were coming. The most shocking part of this vision was that this horde was not riding on horses, but on Christians. Most of them were well-dressed, respectable, and had the appearance of being refined and educated. These were Christians who had opened themselves to the powers of darkness to such a degree that the enemy could use them, and they would think that they were being used by God. The accuser knows that the house divided cannot stand, and this army represented his ultimate attempt to bring such complete division to the church that she would completely fall from grace. I stop here to make this comment. It is done. He has done it. Going back to the reading. The prisoners. Trailing behind these first divisions were a vast multitude of other Christians who were prisoners of this army. They were all wounded, and they were guarded by little demons of fear. There seemed to be more prisoners than there were demons in the army. Surprisingly, these prisoners still had their swords and shields, but they did not use them. It was shocking to see that so many could be kept captive by so few of these little demons of fear. These could have easily been destroyed or driven off if the prisoners had just used their weapons. Above the prisoners, the sky was black with vultures named Depression. These could land on the shoulders of the prisoners and vomit on him. The vomit was condemnation. When the vomit hit the prisoner, he would stand up and march a little straighter for a while, and then slump over, even weaker than before. Again, I wondered why the prisoners did not simply kill these vultures with their swords, which they could have easily done. Occasionally, a weak prisoner would stumble and fall. As soon as he or she hit the ground, the other prisoners would begin stabbing them with their swords, scorning them. As they did so, they would then call for the vultures to begin to devour the fallen one, even before they were dead. For those who wouldn't know, from Ephesians 6, that the sword is the word of God, the two-edged sword, and in the body of Christ, instead of helping one another, we spill condemnation upon the weaker ones, who would be taken over by addiction, drugs, alcohol, adultery, somehow being severely afflicted. Churches are quoting scriptures to them and calling them sinners, despise them, or just ignore their sin like nothing happened to them, which is the worst. Instead of seeing it as an opportunity to minister to them and restore them. Big Joyner was the only one in the entire body of Christ who was willing to give years of his life onto the restoration of Ted Bentley, who developed a terrible reputation after the Florida revival that the Lord so blessed with many miracles and his presence, which then turned into violence. Even Todd participated in kicking the equipment as Satan took him over. Then he had a bad divorce after fell in love with a demon-possessed woman, whom he later married, leaving behind two children. Todd Bentley came out of some occult, his body covered with tattoos, nose rings, and more, and yet Rick Joyner stood with him through it all, receiving all condemnation and criticism from the body, and did not give up until Todd could return to full service of the Lord. It took about 5 years or more. Even I thought that trick Joanna went too far. But do you think the Lord would agree with me? With those who would leave the lost to die? Or with Apostle Joanna? Will he receive a reward in heaven or condemnation for restoring a soul? It came with a great price, great attack, and it took a great sacrifice. We should all see this as an example when we lose heart in ministry, thinking that there is no hope in the one whom we are trying to help. I had one whom I stood by until he began to beat me. Then we just had to separate, because I was powerless against the devil. So, we have a lot to learn. We have a lot to consider. And of course, later on we'll be mentioning of the shield, which is the shield of faith. Shield of faith. So let's go back to the story. Can I repeat a couple of sentences to remember where we left off?
The other prisoners would begin stabbing them with their swords,
scorning them. As they did so,
they would then call for the vultures to begin to devour the fallen one, even before they were dead. As I watched, I realized that these prisoners thought that the vomit of condemnation was truth from God. And I understood that these prisoners actually thought that they were marching in the army of God. This is why they did not kill the little demons of fear or the vultures. They thought these were messengers from God. The darkness from the cloud of vultures made it so hard for these prisoners to see that they were naively accepted everything that happened to them as being from the Lord. The only food provided for these prisoners was the vomit from the vultures. Those who refused to eat it simply weakened until they fell. Those who did eat it were strengthened, but with the strength of the evil ones. They would then begin to vomit on the others. When one began to do this, a demon that was waiting for a ride would be given this one, and he or she would be promoted to the front division. Even worse, when the vomit from the vultures was a repulsive slime, then these demons were urinating and defecating upon the Christians they rode. This slime was the pride and selfish ambition that was the nature of the division they were a part of. However, this slime made a Christian feel so much better than the condemnation that they easily believed that the demons were messengers of God, and they actually thought this slime was the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Then the voice of the Lord came to me saying, "This is the beginning of the enemy's last day army. This is Satan's ultimate deception and his ultimate power of destruction. He is released when he uses Christians to attack other Christians. He has used this army throughout the ages, but never had been able to capture so many to be used for his evil purposes.
Do not fear.
I have an army too. You must now stand and fight, because there is no longer any place to hide from this war. You must fight for my kingdom, for truth, and for those who have been deceived. I have been so repulsed and overraged by the evil army that I had wanted to die rather than live in such a world. However, this word from the Lord was so encouraging that I immediately began yelling to the Christian prisoners that they were being deceived, thinking that they would listen to me. When I did this, it seemed that the whole army turned to look at me, but I kept yelling. I thought that the Christians were going to wake up and realize what was happening to them, but instead many of them started reaching for their arrows to shoot at me. The others just hesitated as if they did not know what to make of me. I knew then that I had done this prematurely and that it had been a very foolish mistake. This is what happened to me. This is my comment. This is what happened to me. Whenever I spoke out in the churches prior to this, I was persecuted. So I understand what he is saying from experience.
Persecution does not necessarily mean that somebody would try to cut my head off, but it means oppression, suppression, quenching of the word, rebuking me, which happened everywhere I went.
The battle begins. And I turned and I saw an army of the Lord standing behind me. There were thousands of soldiers, but we were still greatly outnumbered. Only a small number were fully dressed in their armor, so that most were only partially protected. A large number were already wounded. Most of those who had all of their armor still had very small shields, which I knew would not protect them
from the outslash that was coming. The majority of these soldiers were women and children. Behind this army there was a trailing mob similar to these prisoners who followed the evil army but were different in nature. These seemed to be very happy people and were playing games, singing songs, feasting and roaming about from one little camp to the next. It reminded me of the atmosphere of Woodstock. I tried to raise my voice above the clamor to warn them that it was not the time for this, that the battle was about to begin, but only few could even hear my voice. Those who did gave me the peace sign and said they did not believe in war, and that the Lord would not let anything bad happen to them. I tried to explain that the Lord had given us army for a reason, but they just retorted that they had come to a place of peace and joy where nothing would happen to them. Then I began to earnestly pray to the Lord to increase the faith shield of these and the armor to help us protect those who were not ready for the battle. A messenger came up to me, gave me a trumpet and told me to blow it quickly. I did. And those who had on at least some of their armor immediately responded, snapping to attention. More armor was brought to them, which they put on quickly. I noticed that those who had wounds did not put armor over their wounds, but before I could say anything about this, enemy arrows began to raining down. Everyone who did not have on all of his or her armor was wounded. Those who had no covers, their wounds were struck again in the same place. Those who were hit by arrows of slander immediately began to slander those who were not wounded. Those who were hit with gossip began to gossip, and soon a major division had been created within our camp. Then vultures swooped down to pick up the wounded to deliver them into the camp of prisoners. The wounded still had swords and could have smitten the vultures easily, but they didn't. They were actually carried off willingly because they were so angry at the rest of us. Same among those in the camp behind our army was even worse. There seemed to be total chaos. Thousands lay on the ground wounded and groaning. Many of those who were not wounded just sat in the stupor of unbelief. The wounded and those who sat in unbelief were being quickly carried away by the vultures. Some were trying to help the wounded and keep the vultures off of them, but the wounded were so angry they would threaten and drive away those who were trying to help them. Many who were not wounded were simply running as fast as they could from the scene of battle. This first encounter with the enemy was so devastating that I was tempted to join them in their fight. Then very quickly, some of these began reapproaching with full suits of armor on and large shields. The mirth of the party had changed into an awesome resolve. They began to take the place of those who had fallen and even began to form in new ranks to protect the rear and flanks. Those brought greater courage and everyone resolved to stand and fight until death. Immediately, three great angels named Faith, Hope and Love came and stood behind us and everyone's shield began to grow. Then the story goes on to describe this battle, and since I'm reading from a book, it is adding up to hundreds of pages. I strongly recommend that you read this. Of course, now that we are facing tribulation, people will not have the time anymore or the energy to study as we have been in the wilderness and in homeless shelter, but we had the Bible in our hands and different things to prepare ourselves for this battle. So we are the ones who are going to now snap into position on the front line to fight this army, to fight this last battle. And every one of you who is yet wounded will be immediately healed and empowered by the grace of God and join us in the name of Jesus. I love you. God bless you.